بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله ذي الكرم الواسع والفيض المتتابع الذي بعث إلينا الحبيب الشافع وجاءنا بالفضل الواسع والدين الكامل الجامع، فصلى الله وسلم على من جعله الله المنبع لكل الفضيلة وجعله في الآخرة خير الوسيلة، سيدنا المصطفى محمد وعلى آله الأطهار وأصحابه الأخيار ومن تنور بتلك الأنوار إلى يوم الوقوف بين يديك يا الله يا عزيز يا غفار. أما بعد، السلام عليكم ورحمة الله تعالى وبركاته. We begin by praising and thanking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for his unlimited favors that he has bestowed upon us, and we send salutations, choicest of blessings upon our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam. سبحانك لا علم لنا إلا ما علمتنا إنك أنت العليم الحكيم. جماعة المسلمين، we begin our lecture today with the word of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the opening verses of the second surah in the Quran, Surah Al-Baqarah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives us a very important description of the true believers. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about the muttaqoon or the muttaqeen. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم ألف لام ميم ذلك الكتاب لا ريب فيه هدى للمتقين الذين يؤمنون بالغيب ويقيمون الصلاة ومما رزقناهم ينفقون. صدق الله العلي العظيم. Allah opens up the verses with Alif, Lam and Mim. And majority of scholars, they say, they would mention that these huruful muqatta'at, the cut up letters, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best what Allah means, and Allah says Alif, Lam, Mim. While others have suggested that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala presents a challenge to the disbelievers. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says Alif, Lam, Mim, Allah is telling them that this glorious, inimitable Quran is made up of alifs, lams and memes, ordinary letters that you know, yet you cannot bring the like. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, ذَلِكَ الْكِتَابِ, that is the book, or this is the book, referring to the glorious Quran. لَا رَيْبَ فِيهِ, there is no doubt therein. هُدَلِّ الْمُتَّقِينَ, it's a guidance for those people who have taqwa. And taqwa is a quality every single one of us must desire to have. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala then explains who are the true believers and who are those people who have taqwa. Allah says, الَّذِينَ يُؤْمِنُونَ بِالْغَيْبِ, they believe in the unseen. First quality is they believe in a world beyond the physical world. They believe in things that the eyes cannot see. يُؤْمِنُونَ بِالْغَيْبِ وَيُقِيمُونَ الصَّلَاةَ, they establish prayer, salah. وَيُؤْتُونَ الزَّكَاةَ, they give, they pay, they يُقِيمُونَ الصَّلَاةَ. And then Allah says, وَمِمَّا رَزَقَنَاهُمْ يُنْفِقُونَ, from that which we have given them in sustenance, they spend. And this is a starting point for my lecture today, inshallah ta'ala. The attitude of a believer towards wealth. How does Islam view wealth? The money, whether it's at my home, or whether it's in my bank account, or whether it's in an investment, how does Islam view wealth? مِمَّا رَزَقْنَاهُمْ, the quality of the believers is that they spend not from money that they have accumulated, but they spend that which we have given them in sustenance. Which is very clear that I'm not truly the owner of the wealth that I have. I'm not truly the owner of the wealth I have at home or in my bank account. But Allah is the true owner. And I've only been placed in charge of that wealth. And there are certain duties and obligations with regards to the way I interact with that wealth. And this meaning is emphasized over and over and over in the Quran. So in Surah An-Nisa, Allah says, وَأَنْفِقُوا مِمَّا رَزَقْنَاهُمْ, they spend that which we have given them in sustenance. I want to establish to what extent does Allah stress the point that we're not truly the owners of the wealth. We're not truly the owners of the wealth that we own, that we have in our possession. But Allah is the owner. So in Surah An-Nisa, Allah emphasizes the point, and Allah says, وَأَنْفِقُوا مِمَّا رَزَقَهُمُ اللَّهُ, They spend that which Allah has given them as sustenance. وَأَنفِقُوا مِمَّا رَزَقْنَاهُ مِنْ سُورَةِ الرَّعْدِ. Again, they spend that which we have given them as sustenance. وَأَنفَقُوا مِمَّا رَزَقْنَاهُمْ. They spend that which we have given them in sustenance. Again, Allah says in Surah Fatir. And again in Surah Al-Hadid, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَأَنفِقُوا مِمَّا جَعَلَكُمْ مُسْتَخْلَفِينَ فِيهِ. And this is a beautiful Surah Al-Hadid, describes it in more detail. When Allah says they spend that which we have placed them in charge of. مِمَّا جَعَلَكُمْ مُسْتَخْلَفِينَ فِيهِ. They spend that which we have placed them in charge of. The beauty of the word of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That we are not truly the owners of that wealth that we have within our bank accounts or in our home. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is ultimately the owner. And we are only mustakhlafina fi. We are only placed in charge of it. You know, and like that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in several other verses establishes the same point. You know, and that serves as a starting point today. That the wealth that I own is not truly mine. And I have certain duties and obligations upon me in the manner in which I interact with that wealth. You know, it's a point that perhaps has been made a number of times in the masjid. The importance of charity. The importance of giving. And our Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he emphasizes it in the hadith over and over. One such tradition beautifully, Abdullah ibn Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he says, that inna ahabbal a'mali ila Allah sururun tudkhiluhu ala mu'min. Of the greatest deeds in the eyes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is happiness that you enter upon the heart of a believer. And our Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam refers specifically to someone who finds himself in a difficulty. Takshifu anhu karban. He's in a financial strain and he finds himself in a difficulty and you remove him from that difficulty. So you're entering happiness onto his heart. أو تقضي عنه دينا. You fulfill a debt that he has. You pay the debt on his behalf. تقضي عنه دينا. From the greatest and most beloved actions to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وتطرد عنه جوعا. You push hunger away from him. He finds himself in a state that he cannot purchase food for himself. So you come along and you give charity. And you give him some food or some money for food, and you enter happiness upon his heart. Our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Min ahabbil a'mal," of the most beloved actions to Allah subhanahu wa taala. The benefits of sadaqa jamaatul muslimin. Our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam he told us in a tradition that your good deeds and specifically charity that you give, taqi masari as-su'i wal afati wal halakat. How many of us find difficulties coming our way? This problem and that problem. You know, our lives are filled with difficulties, and if we were to stand and make examples today, it will take the entire duration of the tour. You know, sometimes within our family, sometimes abroad of family, sometimes with my business, sometimes with my practice. Difficulties coming all the time. Our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, with good deeds, specifically charity, it will prevent all harms, calamities, masari asu wal afat wal halakat, prevents anything of that coming your way if you are someone who constantly give charity. So the benefits are many. Our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam he tells us another tradition from the benefits of giving charity and spending in his way. Our Prophet says, "Dawu mardakum bis sadaqah." Take charity, spend in the way of Allah, and in that way you will be treating the ill. That doesn't make sense to us because we know if someone is sick, he goes to hospital. If someone is sick, he goes to the doctor. If someone is sick, he needs to take medicine. You know, because we are so involved, and our minds immediately always run to the physical world, and we forget that there's a metaphysical world. الَّذِينَ يُؤْمِنُونَ بِالْغَيْبِ. They believe in the unseen. So our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, treat your ill by giving charity on their behalf. And this is an important lesson. If I find anyone ill in my family, then I should make it my first duty before I run to the doctor. And medicine is not something bad. Our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam himself took medicine and encouraged us to take medicine. So medicine and seeing the doctor and hospital is all in its place. But at the same time, there's another type of treatment that we cannot afford to ignore, and that is the treatment of sadaqah. So our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam he also said that treat your ill, da'u mardakum bi sadaqah. And like this, there are many virtues. Giving charity in the way of Allah removes one's sins. When Allah speaks about al-mutasaddiqin wal-mutasaddiqat in the Quran, the male and female who give charity, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, أَعَدَّ اللَّهُ لَهُمْ مَغْفِرَةً. Allah prepares forgiveness for them. Who is not in need of the forgiveness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? You know, it's an easy ticket to attain Allah's forgiveness by spending in His way. Giving charity, from the hadith and the ayat of the Quran, we learn that it increases one's wealth. الشيطان يعيدكم الفقر. Shaitan tells you, Allah says, that if you want to spend in His way, you'll experience poverty. الشيطان يعيدكم الفقر. If I have 10,000 rands and I spend 1,000 rands, Shaitan tells me I'll have 9,000 left. And that means decrease. But whose word do we want to take? The word of Shaitan or the word of Allah? Allah says, وَاللَّهُ يَعِدُكُمْ مَغْفِرَةً مِنْهُ وَفَضْلًا. Allah's promise is, when you spend in His way, Allah promise you forgiveness. مَغْفِرَةً مِنْهُ وَفَضْلًا. Allah promises you an increase. So while in this physical world, if I spend 1,000 of 10,000, I'm left with 9,000, and it appears to be a decrease, that's what Shaitan is telling us. But what Allah tells us, there will be an increase. And we all know this, if Allah places barakah in a person's wealth, then what a person can do with 1,000 rand, if there's barakah in it, he could do much more than what another person could do with 100,000 rand that has no barakah in it. وَاللَّهُ يَعِدُكُمْ مَغْفِرَةً مِّنْهُ وَفَضْلًا. Allah promises that He will put an increase within your wealth. Giving charity protects us from the hellfire. It's an indication of true faith. It frees one from bad qualities and traits, and adorns him with beautiful character. It's a door to all other forms of goodness. It allows one to acquire the reward of one who acts with his sadaqah. The point I'm coming to, Jamaatul Muslimin, is that the community is well aware that the masjid is looking for funds. You know, this is something not hidden from the community. The masjid has made an attempt to purchase a property for the expansion of the masjid. You know, a property that would be used as an income, a property that would be used for parking. You know, what way you want to look at the Jamaatul Muslimin, as an increase to the masjid, the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Our Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, whatever the masjid purchases, the masjid becomes the owner of it. The masjid is very similar in Western law to what we would call a juristic person. So like the company I own is a juristic person, the masjid is a juristic person. It owns and it buys in itself. Now, so whatever is purchased in the masjid's name, it belongs to masjid. And nobody should feel for a moment that a property that is not perhaps adjacent to a masjid is no longer masjid. It's owned by the masjid and therefore it's masjid. You know, and the masjid is a very, very important, it should hold a very important position in the heart of every believer. It should be the center of my day, the center of my night, the center of my life, the center of this community has to be the masajid of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And it's not the responsibility of a committee, or 5 or 10 or 15 individuals. It's your responsibility and it's my responsibility. And therefore everyone needs to be involved when it comes to the masjid. And we can see our response when it comes to masjid initiatives, Jamaatul Muslimin, is very poor. And everyone needs to look into himself and ask himself why. Why is it that the masjid is not first in my life? Our Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he told us in the authentic hadith that the masajid are the homes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Ala innal masajid buyutullah. So why is it that the house of Allah comes second, but my home of my family comes first? Why is it that it's easy for me to adorn and make my house beautiful, and to renovate my home, and to make my home more spacious, but I can't do it to the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? How do I face Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on the day of Yawm al-Qiyamah, and Allah says that my house was in need, and you turned away? How do we face Allah? And we have no doubt that the day will come when I will stand before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and Allah will question me of my doings. The masjid is it's the center of the community. The masjid is a place where Muslims meet. The minute someone is absent from the masjid, we should know that that person is ill. A masjid, Jamaatul Muslimin, is a place that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks of greatly in the Holy Quran. But more specifically, Allah speaks greatly of that person who takes time out and dedicates it to the masjid. Allah speaks greatly of that person who takes his wealth and he spends it on the masjid. And he sees to the upkeep of the masjid. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, إِنَّمَا يَعْمُرُ مَسَاجِدَ اللَّهِ مَنْ آمَنَ بِاللَّهِ وَالْيَوْمِ الْآخِرِ إِنَّمَا يَعْمُرُ مَسَاجِدَ اللَّهِ مَنْ آمَنَ بِاللَّهِ وَالْيَوْمِ الْآخِرِ وَأَقَامَ الصَّلَاةَ وَآتَ الزَّكَاةَ وَلَمْ يَخْشَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ فَعَسَى أُولَٰئِكَ أَنْ يَكُونُوا مِنَ الْمُهْتَدِينَ. And I want everybody to give some serious thought to this verse in the Quran. And Allah says that only those people who believe in Allah, they establish prayer, they give zakat, they fear none but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, only those people will see to the upkeep of a masjid. So the reality, Jamaatul Muslimin, is Allah going to use me for the progress of a masjid, or will Allah not use me? When I am involved in the upkeep of the masjid, then it's a sign that I'm from those people who have iman. It's a sign that I'm from those people who establish prayer. It's a sign that I'm from those people who pay zakah. And it's a sign that I'm from those people who fear none but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So will I be from those people or not? Will I support the cause of the home of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala or will I not? And perhaps something to end off with, Jamaatul Muslimin. The bottom line and the major problem that we have today, Jamaatul Muslimin, and the root cause for all evil in the world, as our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam told us in the hadith, is that we love this world too much. We love wealth too much. Difficult for us to part. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said that the time will come when the nations of the world will encroach upon the Muslims. And how wild prey and beast surround their prey. If you look in the jungle, the way wild beast, we can perhaps picture a pack of hyenas surrounding a prey. And the Prophet says, thus the nations of the world will surround the Muslim Ummah. And the Muslim Ummah will become weaker and weaker. And the companions radiallahu ta'ala anhum, they found this very strange. And they said, Ya Rasulullah, أَمِنْ كِلَّةِ نَحْنُ يَوْمَئِذٍ. Will it perhaps be on account of little numbers that the world will be able to encroach upon the Muslim Ummah? And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, no. That time the Muslims will be many, much more than what they were in the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will place in the hearts of believers al-wahan. And the companions asked, Ya Rasulullah, what is this wahan that Allah will place in the hearts of the believers? And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, that is the love of this dunya and fear of death. And that's the root cause, Jamaatul Muslimin, for the sad state of affairs. The more we love this world, and the more we find it difficult to part with this world, the deeper and deeper the Muslim ummah will fall in a rut. And there will be degeneration, and there won't be progress. And the more we detach ourselves from this world, the more we find it easy to part with wealth, the more honor Allah will grant this ummah. And the more progress there will be. You know, and eventually, the time will come, as our Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala promised us in His Quran, the time when we will be the rulers of this world. And it all starts with detaching myself from this world. As our companions radiallahu ta'ala anhum were. We all know the story of Abu Bakr as-Siddiq. Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he says in a tradition narrated by Imam Al-Hakim that we were on a particular expedition and we left home. And before leaving home, the Prophet strongly encouraged us to give charity and to spend our wealth in the cause of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in the cause of Islam. And Umar radiallahu ta'ala an, he said he left home with such an amount of wealth that he said, today will be the day wherein I beat Abu Bakr as-Siddiq. Well, Abu Bakr was unbeatable in terms of all good deeds. One morning, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he stood up in Masjid al-Nabawi and he made announcements. And he said, who of you has given his share of charity for the day? And everyone kept silent. This is Fajr in the Masjid of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And Abu Bakr as-Siddiq stands up and he says, Ya Rasulullah, on my way to Masjid, on my way to Mosque, I passed by a man who was in a state where he had no food in his home, and I gave him some charity. And Umar radiallahu ta'ala looked in dismay and he says, Ya Rasulullah, that's only Fajr. And then Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is asked, who of you has visited any ill person for this day? And Umar again says, Ya Rasulullah, it's only Fajr. And Abu Bakr stands up and he says, Ya Rasulullah, on my way to mosque, I heard that my one brother is ill, and I took a different route to masjid this morning, and I paid him a visit before Fajr, and then I came to the masjid. And Umar said, Ya Rasulullah, it's only Fajr. And as the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam went on, whom of you did this, and whom of you did that? Five or six things mentioned in the hadith. And every time the Prophet asked the question, Umar said, it's only Fajr. Abu Bakr stands up and he says, Ya Rasulullah, I managed to do this before Fajr. So on this day, Umar radiallahu ta'ala an, he says that today I was sure that today will be the day where I beat Abu Bakr as-Siddiq. And he came out on the expedition and the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam asked him, Ya Umar, what did you bring? And he said, Ya Rasulullah, I brought half of my estate. What does half a person's estate mean? Umar radiallahu anhu is a grown man. He has more than half his life savings with him. And he says, half of that I brought to give in the way of Allah. And Rasulullah asked him, what did you leave with your family? And he says, I left the other half with my family. And Umar was pleased and happy until Abu Bakr as-Siddiq came along. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam asked Abu Bakr as-Siddiq, what have you presented and what did you bring with as charity? And Abu Bakr said, Ya Rasulullah, I brought my entire estate. And when the Prophet asked him, what did you leave home with your family? Ma abqaytum li ahlikum. Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu says, that I left behind with my family, Allah and the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Completely detached from this world. And therefore Abu Bakr as-Siddiq is known, you know, by nearly consensus that he was the greatest of all the companions radiallahu ta'ala anhu. Umar radiallahu anhu, in the time of his khalifa, and I'll conclude with this incident inshallah ta'ala. Umar radiallahu ta'ala an, he used to get his salary from the Baytul Mal. Because he had to take care of the needs of people. He was the Qadi, he was the judge, he was the Mufti. He spent his life taking care of the needs of people, fulfilling, answering questions, passing judgment, leading the Salah in the Masjid. And therefore he could not go out to work and he had to receive a salary from the Baytul Mal. But Umar stressed that the salary has to be bare minimum. Only what he requires and only what he needs. And his wife, Fatima radiallahu ta'ala anha, you know, she said that a new type of luxury entered Medina al-Munawwara. You know, some type of suite that the scholar that documents the story, he says it resembles al-Murabba today. Jam. Now, how much value does one attach to jam? And the wife of Umar ibn Khattab, she says, you know, perhaps I will surprise my husband and buy some jam for him. So she asked him for some extra money to buy this jam. And Umar radiallahu anhu says, there's no money for any extra. You know what the state of Umar radiallahu anhu is? Whatever money there is for groceries for the week or for the month, that is it, and there's nothing more than that. So what the wife of Umar radiallahu anhu does is, she saves, the word used is a daniq, a small amount of money that probably equals 5 rands. So her entire month goes by and she saves 1 daniq. And the second month goes by and she saves a 2nd daniq. And the third month a 3rd daniq and the 4th month a 4th daniq. Then eventually the amount that she saves equals something similar to a 20 rand. After 4 months, and she goes to the marketplace and she buys this jam for Umar radiallahu ta'ala an. And the intention of course is to surprise him. And Umar comes home that night for supper. And the surprise that they have for his supper is jam. What do I do if I come home and there's jam on the table for me? But Umar asked, where does this come from? The salary of Umar cannot afford this murabba, this jam. Where does it come from? You know, and with delight in the heart, she explains to Umar that, you know, 4 months ago I started saving for this evening. We shall serve you something new. And I managed to save that amount for the first month and the second month and the third and the fourth. Every month I danik, I save this amount and this is what I'm presenting to you. And Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu becomes upset. And he makes the announcement and he goes to the Baytul Mal that as of today the Baytul Mal has to pay Umar radiallahu anhu one danik less every month. Because Umar is not in need of that extra danik every month. Detached from this world, and like Umar was the balance of the companions, and of Salaf al-Salih, pious predecessors, and the great scholars and luminaries of the Ummah. And our time to allow, we could mention several incidents within the lives of the scholars. Mawla Qasim al-Nanotwi, the founder of the Darul Ulum Diyoban, he used to receive a salary, a bare minimum salary. You know, perhaps, by example, 100 rupees. And when he would receive his salary, you'd see that perhaps my rental is 20 rupees and I require approximately 10 rupees per week or 15 or 20 for the month, and if he received 100 rupees and what he required was a bare minimum of 40 rupees, he would not sleep the night he received his salary until he would go around walking in the roads looking for people and giving charity till eventually he returns home with such an amount that just suffices him for the month. So we develop this quality, Jamaatul Muslimin, and we learn to spend in the cause of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You know, Allah becomes happy with us. The Ummah progresses. We become better people and we become the leaders of the world again. And it all starts with me departing with my wealth. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guide us and we allow us to realize the importance of giving charity in His way. The masjid again has been collecting for more than a week, nearly 2 weeks now. And the progress is that they've collected 35,000 rands. The target, which is 100,000 rands, after 1.5 weeks they collected 35,000 rands.